Hi, everyone, and welcome. Thanks for joining us from YouTube and Twitter for this live stream public dialogue on immigration challenges and choices, people, principles, and priorities. We're so grateful to have so many of you joining us here today from around the country. We've got more than 1,400 RSVPs, which shows how concerned people are about this issue. We'll have an opportunity for questions and answers later on, so please submit questions to the panelists by following the prompts at the bottom of your screen. And please also share your thoughts on social media using the hashtag #immigrationchallenges and by tagging the initiative at GUCSTPublicLife on Twitter. So now, if we can believe the polls, Americans consistently show broad bipartisan support for comprehensive immigration reform. And yet our southern border has, through at least three presidential administrations, been the site of a humanitarian crisis. Families, individuals, and unaccompanied minors have fled violence, poverty, corrupt governments, and natural disasters in search of something better, only to have those hopes too often dashed at the border. During the Trump administration, the suffering reached a new level, with cruelty intentionally used to drive policy as children were deliberately separated from their families, the government engaged in mass deportation raids, immigrants were demonized from the bully pulpit, and immigration was used as a wedge issue for partisan gain. President Biden promised to make this cruel and broken system fair and humane, and he made bold reform proposals. He's begun to reverse some damage, but in the face of significant challenges, he has yet to deliver on some major promises. Migrants are still being turned away under a Trump emergency regulation. And while President Biden promised to lift the cap on refugees and rebuild the refugee resettlement program, he has yet to take an important step necessary to move those promises forward. Now, meanwhile, Pope Francis had made migration a priority in his pontificate, seeing the welcome of migrants as fundamentally a moral and not political issue. Again and again, he has called us to stand in solidarity with those lying wounded on the roadside and to remember that each migrant has a name, a face, and a story. So at this time of continuing challenges, old divisions, and new leadership, our treatment of immigrants and refugees is a national moral and religious test. What are our responsibilities and opportunities here as people of faith and as Americans? What are the elements of just policy and compassionate reform? The initiative is happy to be hosting a discussion of these important questions with a remarkable group of leaders with diverse experiences as a journalist, a DACA student, a national evangelical leader, and a Catholic bishop serving on the border. Joining us today are Reverend Walter Kim, the president of the National Association of Evangelicals and the pastor for leadership at Trinity Presbyterian Church in Charlottesville, Virginia. Sabrina Rodriguez, a correspondent for Politico, where she covers U.S. immigration realities and policies. Bishop Mark Seitz, the Bishop of El Paso, Texas, where he serves a borderland community whose sister city is Ciudad Juarez, Mexico. And Lauren, a freshman at Georgetown and a DACA recipient who came to the United States as a young girl from Colombia. And so now let's move the conversation forward. Sabrina, you're an immigration reporter for Politico, doing remarkable work bringing the stories of migrants and the human face of this crisis to your readers. In your powerful reporting, you've met with migrants, with community leaders, with local officials at our southern border. Help set the stage for us. What's going on at the border now? What are the human challenges and policy choices the Biden administration and the nation face? And what's different from the last administration and what's the same?
Well, first of all, thank you so much for the introduction, Kim. And I think you've set the stage to some extent already on what we've seen and what's been going on. But, you know, the Biden administration inherited the Trump administration's immigration policy that was extremely restrictive. And the goal in large part was to cut off migration, was to cut off the acceptance of asylum seekers. So the Biden administration, you know, we saw President Joe Biden on the campaign trail talk very much about how he wanted to reform the immigration system. He wanted to create a fair and humane immigration system. Now, saying it and doing it are two very different things, and there are very real challenges to accomplishing that. What we've seen in the first months, and this has been happening since April 2020, so I think that's an important point, is since April 2020, we've seen the number of migrants coming to the U.S.-Mexico border increase. Because of the pandemic, the vast majority of the people that are arriving at the border are being sent back immediately, which I can kind of talk about the mechanism that they use for that and all later. But The Biden administration has been using the same mechanism that the Trump administration used to send back the majority of people. Still, we are accepting unaccompanied children, and we are seeing record numbers of unaccompanied children arriving at this point. So it's been a challenge. You know, the day-to-day challenges that the Biden administration has faced above all has been figuring out how to safely shelter these children, because they, you know, when the kids arrive in the United States, they're taken in by Border Patrol, by CBP custody, which is pretty unanimously, we all agree, not a place for children. It's not the most humane conditions. It's much more like jail-like cells. So it's a process of getting the kids out of there and into shelters that are run by the Department of Health and Human Services. Those shelters have, you know, medical services, educational services, and the children stay there until they're matched with a family member, a sponsor in the United States. And I think a very important clarification, because there is a misconception around this, is these children are not being sent to just randomly come into the United States and by themselves. Many have family members here. Many have a parent already in the United States to be reunited with. So that's a part of it. We're also seeing an increase in the number of families that are arriving. And there's kind of a mismatch and some confusion around who gets to stay, who gets sent back. Some families are being allowed to remain in the United States. Some are being sent back to Mexico. So there's some chaos and confusion in just the process and the way it's being administered at the moment. But I think it's very important to note that when we're seeing these big numbers of, you know, 172,000 migrants were apprehended at the border, it's not 172,000 people that, you know, that were let loose in the United States and there's no order and there's no system. I mean, there's a very real system. And, you know, I think part of my experience and talking about this and writing about this that really impacted it was going to the border myself, and was going, and I spent time in Brownsville, McAllen, and El Paso, and getting to see firsthand. I mean, there's one thing you hear in Washington, and there's a very different thing that you hear when you are talking to people that are dealing with the day-to-day challenges. Nobody at the border, for the most part, is talking to you about, oh, because Biden said this, or Trump said that, or the politics about it. It's very much a, okay, we're used to this. We know what to do. We know how to handle this. And we're just concerned about getting these people safely, you know, getting them fed, getting them clothed, getting them to their final destination with their family, and really kind of wanting to move past the politics of all of this. And really what we're seeing in Washington right now is the Biden administration is trying to some extent change the way we talk about this and you know, look at it from a more comprehensive standpoint, and let's reframe the way we talk about migrants and the way we talk about immigration. But we're still waiting to see if Congress will step up and actually do something, because the reality is that while the Biden administration can make certain changes, while it can push, you know, the countries in Central America, Guatemala, Honduras, El Salvador, Mexico to do things, it's going to take Congress taking action, which it has not done and has just repeatedly failed to do.
Thanks for that, Sabrina. That's wonderful. And now you talked a little bit about how important it is to actually be at the border and go to the border. Let's go to you, Bishop Seitz, because of course you are at the border. You're the Bishop of El Paso, which is a community deeply affected by our broken immigration system. I'm always so grateful that you've taken action and that you visibly frequently stand with migrants, and you've written powerful pastoral letters about the suffering of migrants and our responsibilities as Catholics to those in need, including as the signatory to a recent joint statement of the bishops along the border in the United States and Northern Mexico. You've also said that we should find ways to transcend the partisanship, and instead of politicizing it, we should try to Christianize this issue. So what biblical mandates and Catholic principles and other moral principles should shape paths forward on immigration reform? And what are our responsibilities as Catholics when faced with these complicated and intractable issues, which have so much human suffering at their core? Also, what's the responsibility of the United States to its citizens and also to immigrants?
Well, thank you very much. Thanks for the question. And I'd like to begin by saying that I believe Sabrina gave an excellent summary of the situation we're experiencing on the border, and summarizing the complex situations that we're seeing. What ends up being reported by people who don't really know what's happening or bring a certain bias to the discussion, it is far from the reality that we experience from day to day. I did make a comment recently, and for me, it summed up much of what I'm feeling. It's almost like now I've been here long enough. I've been in El Paso 8 years to see this cycle continue. And what I've seen is that every time we get this cyclical kind of increase in people that are seeking refuge here in this country, the politicians fall into place, and you hear them saying the exact same things. They could have just replayed it from 2014 or 2019 and now. Basically trying to take their position and gain some political, have some political gain with their base. And I was saying, maybe it's time to stop politicizing these issues and begin Christianizing them, because it seems that many of us who consider ourselves Christians, we have pretty well set aside what our faith should be telling us about these issues as though it really doesn't apply. It can't be lived out in reality in this world of ours. But the truth is, if you are a disciple of Jesus, and this would apply to people of many other faith backgrounds, then it gives you a perspective that is very clear about these matters. I could list so many different parables that Jesus told and teachings that he gave, and we don't have time for all of those. Let me just mention the Good Samaritan, Lazarus at the wall of the rich man. You know, our situation at the border is so much like that. You know, people are at our door and they're begging to come in for refuge, something that's really not spoken very often. You know, we're so focused on this border situation that we don't ask ourselves, why are they leaving home? Why are they coming? And it's not because they're trying to get a nicer car. It's because they are fleeing. If only we would begin to understand this, that the situation in Central America is very, very bad right now, very difficult. It has violence comparable to war zones, Syria, Afghanistan, when you start talking about homicide rates and the like. So people are fleeing, and the gospel is very clear about what we should be doing in terms of our reception of people in need. And we have the assurance that we're not going to just be depending upon our own resources, but those of the Lord who's able to take five loaves and two fish and feed a multitude. We've just got to start living as though we really believe what he says. Well, that would be a help. I know that not everyone's a Christian, but let's start with us.
Absolutely. Let's start with us. Walter, I want to go from Bishop Seitz's wonderful words to you now. You became the head of the National Association of Evangelicals in January. You're a well-respected pastor and a scholar and the son of refugee parents. You bring so much to this conversation, your knowledge, your thoughtfulness, your faith, but your own family story as well, and your journey to ministry and leadership in the evangelical community, as well as your personal identity and experience as a Korean American. So in light of those experiences and as a Christian, how does this situation challenge and even test us as a nation and as a people of faith? What are the moral and human dimensions of the violence against Asian Americans as well? We can't leave that out of this conversation. And how should the religious community respond?
Kim, thank you very much for those questions and, more importantly, for the invitation to this amazing conversation. I want to pick up perhaps where Bishop Seitz had left us. As a follower of Jesus, as an evangelical, I want to take seriously our identity as God's people. And first, I would like to note that the Bible is a story of migration. You think of Abraham and his call in Genesis 12. It was a migration call to move from one nation to another. the time that Israel spent in Egypt. And as refugees leaving that country of oppression, in that period of oppression, to the promised land. And then even into the New Testament, God's people is described in 1 Peter as strangers and foreigners journeying through this world to our ultimate homeland. So essentially, to be a Christian is to be a migrant. It's to enter into the story of migration, the biblical story of migration. But it's also a call to be hospitable, to extend hospitality to those who are migrating. And so the call of God's people in the Old Testament that you should not wrong the sojourner among you or oppress him because you yourself were once a sojourner in Egypt. Personally, I have witnessed the church extend that kind of identity and hospitality. I did not grow up as an evangelical or in an evangelical household. As you noted, Kim, my father was a refugee escaping communist China, and he literally, his family crossed a river in barrels in the middle of the night to get to South Korea. There, they were welcomed by many Christian organizations. Eventually, my father actually got his medical education at the Catholic Medical College in Seoul, Korea. And when we immigrated to America in the mid-60s, when my parents immigrated, I was born in the States. One of the first households I actually remember was an Irish Catholic family that had welcomed us to live with them in the Bronx. And then I think of the Lutheran pastor that helped my family immigrate, my parents immigrate. So my own story is a story of people of faith who understood the experience of being migrants and in turn extended hospitality to others. I think we're at a pivotal moment in our country. That kind of understanding that not only as God's people are we essentially a migrant people, but this country is essentially a migrant country. Other than the Native Americans, we are migrants who have journeyed here. And despite the fact that there have been times in our country that have been incredibly inhospitable, there have also been very beautiful moments where people of faith have been at the vanguard of extending hospitality to those who have come here. And we have an opportunity as evangelicals, as Catholics, to partner together and to recover and strengthen and extend this sense of a call as God's migrant people to in turn extend hospitality to those who are migrating.
Thanks so much for that, Walter, and thanks for sharing your story. And now, Lauren, I'd love to turn to you and hear your story. You're part of the Georgetown family, and you're finishing your first year soon, having spent it in the middle of this COVID-19 pandemic. You're courageously stepping forward here tonight. You and I had a chance to talk recently, and I'd love for you to tell people here what you told me, how your family came to the United States, when you learned about your immigration status, what's it been like as a Georgetown student in the middle of COVID-19 and as a DACA recipient? Go ahead.
Hello, yes, thank you for having me here. At the age of 3, my mother and I flew to the United States from Colombia. We landed in Boston, Massachusetts. My father had arrived before us just to see how life was in the U.S. The reason my parents had decided to come to the United States was because life in Colombia was not great. There were not enough jobs, and it was dangerous. Back in Colombia, my father was a truck driver where he transported goods for farmers, and my mom was a stay-at-home wife. Our financial status was not the best. They both wanted me to have a better life, a life with more opportunities. We arrived in 2005, but I did not learn about my status until my freshman year of high school in Boston, where I enrolled in a private school. I first asked my mom why she couldn't put my social security number, and that's when I found out we were all undocumented. This took a toll on me emotionally, because at that time, I found it unfair that my younger twin brothers were citizens, but I did not have that privilege. As a student, I was not the best, but I promised myself I would be the top student so I could repay my parents for all the sacrifices they had made. As I started learning more about college, Georgetown started to become my number one school because it was right in the capital, and I knew many doors would open as a result. When I got accepted, it was a huge blessing because my dad did not graduate from high school and my mom never got the chance to go to college. So I will be the first in my immediate family to attend and graduate from college. I constantly struggle with being stuck between two countries because I am from Colombia, but I have no knowledge of what life is like there. I only know the cultures my parents brought with them. I am not fully accepted in the U.S. because I am not a citizen. 2 months ago, my family had received positive COVID tests. This was due to the fact that they are frontline workers. They work at a grocery store in the deli department. My dad was vulnerable because he had a couple of health issues in the past. So when he was diagnosed with COVID, he was immediately admitted into the hospital. I remember talking to him and thinking that it might be the last time I would speak to him, because every time that I talked to him, he would just get worse. I really admire my mom for taking on the responsibility of the house and taking care of my 9-year-old brothers when she was sick as well. Luckily, now everyone is healthy and back to work, but it might be different for other families because not all families have been as fortunate. But my heart goes out to all the families that are struggling with COVID and their status.
Thanks so much for that, Lauren. We really appreciate you bringing that story to this conversation. And it's so important to keep that kind of story, your story and the story of so many others, front and center as we talk about these issues. So thank you very much for being here. Sabrina, I'd like to turn back to you now, maybe get a little bit more in the nitty gritty of the policy issues at stake here. I'm already seeing questions come in asking things like, you know, what are the ages? What does it mean to be a child in this system? Like, what counts as a child here? I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about the human impacts and the central policy choices and issues at stake here. Maybe things like the rollback of the Remain in Mexico policy, COVID-19 at the border, issues regarding asylum, anything you think is necessary for us to understand it at a little bit of a deeper level.
Yeah, so I mean, what we've seen so far has been the Biden administration on day one announced that they had, you know, their idea of what a citizenship bill, it's called the United States Citizenship Act, and it would be the comprehensive immigration reform bill that they've put forth. That is, I mean, many people on the Hill will tell you it's dead on arrival, it's not going anywhere because they don't have Republican support. But it does give us a sense of what the Biden administration wants to do and what it has envisioned for immigration in the United States. And it would offer a pathway to citizenship for the undocumented, the more than 11 million undocumented immigrants in the United States. It would offer, you know, a way, it offer more legal pathways for people to be able to come. Because a big part of this conversation too is, you know, there's this perception of the right way to come, or, you know, the legal way to come. But there aren't many ways to do that. If you are a family that's fleeing violence, in Guatemala right now, or if you are, you know, your children are malnourished and you just want an opportunity, there aren't opportunities to do that. And that is a big problem here. And I think something that also gets, you know, confused in all of this is, it is a legal right to seek asylum. That is, it is legal to seek asylum. But right now, the way to do that, the way that people would seek asylum, is you have to be within the borders of that country. Therefore, you'd cross the border. So part of what the Biden administration wants to do is create these different pathways so that if you are trying to seek a better life and you live in one of these countries, that you can go somewhere there and, you know, fill out a form and you're part of a process. And I was talking to someone yesterday, actually, that compared it to in Cuba. And I'm actually, my family's Cuban. In Cuba, the system has been, there's been a parole system for years where you'd apply and you have family in the United States that could request you and such. And every year, a certain amount of people would be able to come to the United States. And it's kind of that sense of this orderly process where, you know, a lot of people years ago in Cuba would be getting on rafts, and many people died on the trip from Cuba to the United States, similar to what we see people crossing the border at times of, you know, either drowning or deaths or murders and such. But having a process where you don't have to do that dangerous journey, where you could just in, from within your home say, okay, I don't feel safe here. I want to leave here. These are ways that I can do this effectively. So there's a lot of talk about that and how to accomplish that. And the first steps we've seen the Biden administration take is part of rolling back things from the Trump era. So you mentioned the Remain in Mexico program. Under Trump, he, as I mentioned at the beginning, he really wanted to cut off the asylum system. And it was very much a process too of deterrence. So to do that, he created an agreement with Mexico where if you crossed the border into the United States, if you were trying to seek asylum in the United States, while your case was processed, you had to stay in Mexico. Mexico didn't really have the infrastructure built to take that on. So what ended up happening was thousands of people living in these makeshift camps. And we've heard plenty of stories, and there's been plenty of reporting about, you know, just the circumstances in those camps. So the Biden administration ended that program, stopped enrolling people in it, and decided to start slowly letting in the people that were in the camps. And there's people that had been there for up to 2 years. So it was a process of slowly but surely they, you know, and because of part of this whole perception of chaos at the border, they wanted to start small so that they could, you know, go ramping it up and see what worked. They've been working with the United Nations, with different non-governmental organizations to make sure people get tested before they come, to make sure that there's a place to welcome them to. And they've been doing that. So far, they've let in more than 6,500 of the people that were in the program. And it's a total of about 25,000 that were enrolled and they're working on being able to bring into the country. So that's kind of one of the big pieces that they've been working on. They also have restarted a program that Trump ended called the Central American Minors Program that allows for children that have family members in the United States, that have a parent in the United States. It would allow you to apply for this program and then be brought on a plane after the vetting and all the processing to the United States to be reunited with that person. That's considered definitely a template to help with the question of unaccompanied children arriving. And I will say, when we're talking about unaccompanied children, there's a huge range. It can be, you know, 17-year-old boys, it could be 12-year-old girls. I mean, we've seen a whole range of ages. And one unintended consequence of the Biden administration sending back families in some places has been that now we're starting to see more children they came with their family and they were turned away. And then the family has decided, okay, well, at least let's try and get our child into the country. And then we're seeing more unaccompanied children that would not have been unaccompanied, that would have been with a family member had they not been sent back. So right now, I think the Biden administration, to some extent, is holding on its policy and is just, we're trying to send back as many families as possible. We're trying to send as many adults back as possible. But something that I keep hearing from immigrant advocates and from folks that are really following this closely is that's going to have to change soon. That is going to have to change soon because of some of the consequences that we're seeing from the way they're handling it so far.
Thanks so much, Sabrina. That's all important background and context for us to have as we talk about all of this. And Bishop Sykes, I'd like to turn to you now. I love your reaction to anything you've heard so far, but before we get there, I don't think that we can have a conversation with you without talking about the August 2019 shooting in El Paso, a horrific mass shooting of Latinos by a person with white nationalist beliefs. What role do you think racism plays at the border and in these issues, and how can we work against that? And also, how's your community responding to that shooting, both then and now? Thanks very much.
Those are big questions. Yes, I don't think there's any question that racism plays a role here. And one message we often give to politicians is watch your language. Be careful about what you say. If you are painting a situation at the border of chaos, it's using words like invasion and criminals are coming across and so on, then there are certainly groups that respond to that. They appeal to the fear that people have. And that fear leads very often to surface a racism that it has been so much a part of our life in this country from its beginning. And sad to say, it is based very often on the color of a person's skin, the language that they speak, the country that they come from. And we could talk about this for a long time, obviously, but it was interesting that at one point, President Trump expressed a real willingness to receive people from Norway and Sweden, right? But and you don't, if you look at the longer border that we have with Canada, you'll see an entirely different approach. But towards those who are coming from south of the border, there is mixed in with so many other issues, this unconscious, I think, very often, attitude that is fearful of people who are different than we are, and particularly that difference very often ends up in attitudes that are, how can we get around the word? Racist. We're judging a whole people by the color of their skin. And that's really what it comes down to. So it's a grave concern. And what brought home to me this, the fact that this is not just something that sometime we in this country ought to deal with. It's unfortunate that people have this judgment. What became clear to me on August 3rd, 2019, is that this attitude is death dealing, that there are always going to be some who express these attitudes in a way that leads to murder. And this young man drove 600 and plus miles, nearly 700 miles to come to El Paso, to my home, and to attack people as they were shopping on a Saturday morning, to kill as many people as he could whom he felt were invading our country. So it has an impact. And I know that Reverend Kim could certainly address this, the impact it's had on Asian Americans. We could speak about the impact that these ingrained attitudes of racism are having on African Americans. It's all the same reality.
Thanks so much for that, Bishop Seitz. And I would like to turn to you now, Walter, and talk a little bit about, I'd love your reaction to what you've heard so far. But also, I noted that Sabrina mentioned that President Biden's proposed legislation has no Republican support. And we've already had a couple questions coming in about the fact that Congress is in many ways so dysfunctional and you can't get anything done. I'm wondering if you can talk a little bit about anything you've heard, but also how we might build support for just and compassionate immigration reform. And tell us a little bit about what the NAE thinks about this, thinks about the elements of that kind of reform.
We are still a democracy, fraught with challenges, of course, but the people have a voice. And the utilization of that voice is predicated on a few things. One, an informed citizenship. So it's absolutely critical for information to get out and for that information to be distributed in churches, that whether it's in the form of sermons and classes, whether it's in the form of experiences that are fostered by many organizations that enable people to learn, not simply just with data, but with alliances, with exposure to relationships. I think of one of our member organizations, World Relief, which is actually the humanitarian arm of the National Association of Evangelicals. They in the past have hosted trips to the border for pastors to be able to actually experience what is going on. And that has been transformative. These pastors go back and they preach differently because they have been informed, but informed in a way that also includes befriending, building bridges across differences. So it's not just words on a paper. It's actual living, breathing people with whom you have cried or laughed or lamented or hoped. And the last thing I would say is not only be informed and be a friend, but be an advocate. And this is something that I didn't mention in the earlier question, but I think every Asian American, when that video was released of the older Asian woman that was beaten and the security guards that through the glass window and door saw it, but closed the door and turned away. That is not only a horror and tragedy, but a grand metaphor of what so often happens. We just have bystander apathy. We turn away. For me, that struck very personally because my sister used to live just a few blocks from that complex, and she used to walk those streets. It was profoundly troubling for any Asian American who could see their own mother, their own sister, their own sibling themselves within that context. But the metaphor of just closing the door and turning away is what so often happens. At the NAE, one of the things that we want to do is to not close the door and turn away, to equip churches to engage. And we have some guiding principles with the issue of immigration, immigration reform, refugee resettlement, all issues that the NAE is highly committed to, and we've written about formally in a number of places, including a document called For the Health of the Nation. But some of the principles have been respect for the God-given dignity of every person, respect for and protection of the unity of the family as God's gift to humanity upon which all healthy societies are built. Part of the problem of the partisanship of this moment is I think we need to also enter into some tough discussions about what is the nature of respective rule of law, securing national borders. We need to demonstrate an ability to join these issues together. And I would hope that these conversations would enable us to do that.
Thanks so much. And I hope that that's part of what we're trying to do here today is to resist that bystander apathy, to know that this issue is something that should be central for all of us. We're about to get to your questions, those of you who are watching, and thank you so much for sending in so many wonderful questions. But before we do that, I'd like to turn to you, Lauren. I'd love to hear your reaction to what you've heard so far. And if you could say, what's one thing people watching today should know about the system and how it affects people like your family, you and your family, what would you tell people watching this call, watching the Zoom call, and the leaders of this country, if you could tell them one really important thing?
Wow, yes. I would like to emphasize the fact that there are many people who are risking their lives. So each time politicians want to abolish DACA or do not fulfill their promises on immigration policies, I just want to tell people to be aware that it's our lives, the lives of my parents and many others that are in their hands. I also believe we all deserve to be in this country. Our community deserves rights. As you know, I am a DACA student who is currently attending Georgetown University, but not all DACA or undocumented individuals have to go to elite colleges in order to be deserving of citizenship, because they're all working hard in order to make an honest living for themselves and for their families. I believe it is time that we move towards a more permanent immigration policy that no other president can take away. And any policy or policies that the U.S. adopts should uplift families like mine.
Thanks so much for that, Lauren. We really appreciate it. And now I'd like to turn to questions that are coming in from the audience. We're getting a lot of questions on the refugee cap, right? The limit to the number of refugees that are allowed here into the United States. President Biden promised to lift that cap, but he hasn't taken an important step towards resolving that. What's up with that, Sabrina? Can you help us understand what's going on?
Yes. So that's something that's gotten a lot of attention in the past couple of days of people realizing that he said he was going to do this and then didn't. Part of it right now that we're hearing is the political calculations of all of this, and has been that because of the perception of what's happening at the border, he has been more hesitant to actually act on what he said, which is confusing and upsetting to those who understand both systems, because the asylum system and the refugee cap have nothing to do with each other. They are separate issues, but just because of the way that the American public perceives the immigration system and because of the way that Washington handles immigration, it's getting caught up in politics is really the short answer of what's happening right now. So it's unclear if because there's been more attention on this, I think it's the New York Times and the Washington Post had stories come out this week about it. I'm starting to think that Biden will have to say something because he's seeing that there's much more attention on it lately. But yes, but at this point, it's an unfulfilled promise. He, unprompted in the first weeks of the administration, said he was going to raise it, especially after record low numbers in the Trump administration of allowing refugees admissions. And now we are seeing that he has not signed the paperwork necessary to see that happen. So it's, I would say immigrant advocates feel that because there's more attention coming to it, that there's a chance that maybe he will reverse course and follow through with what he had initially said. But at this point, we haven't seen any indication of that.
Well, glad we can bring attention to it here. And I'd also love to bring attention to another issue that we've touched on in this conversation so far. And Bishop Seitz, I wonder if I might come to you with this question. We have someone asking really a good question. Is it safe for people to go to a site in their home country to register if we already hear about the need to escape violent gangs and the danger that's there in those home countries? I wonder if you could talk a little bit more about the conditions in Central America and other places that push people to immigrate here to the U.S.
Thank you. I appreciate the question, because it does something that's very important. It begins to change the focus from this line that we nations create, right, we call a border, and to look at the sending countries, the places from which immigrants are coming. We're only going to begin to address these issues of immigration if we begin to understand that immigration isn't resolved by having controls on the border. Immigration is a much bigger issue, as Reverend Kim pointed out. It's a human issue. Migration is something that human beings do. Have your DNA analyzed sometime and find out where your family came from. And as the studies reveal, humanity has expanded from one place to another, right? So it's also not controlled by us ultimately. It's controlled by factors such as what are people enduring where they live, and what is happening with the economy here. It responds to those kinds of conditions. And in fact, we've seen that play out. Even with all our efforts to control immigration, the one thing that seems to have had an impact on immigration from Mexico is that the economy in Mexico was very poor at one time. We received millions of immigrants. It improved even in the face of other issues with gang violence and so on. The economy in Mexico improved, and most people are unaware that we've seen negative migration from the United States to Mexico in the last about 20 years. So it responds to those kinds of issues. If we really want to slow down migration, we help the countries that they're coming from to have a better, safer system, a better economy. So the situation right now in what we call the Northern Triangle of Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala, is that the economy is in a shambles. They face two hurricanes. There is narco trafficking, gang violence, and the like that makes the situation extremely unstable. And so if a person feels they need to leave, they very often don't have time to say, well, I'm going to apply, right? And one thing that this country has considered is to allow people to apply for asylum from the home country, but they're also going to have to consider giving people a safe place for them to wait during that time. And there hasn't been the will to do that. So the only option that they really have is to take their chances right now.
Thanks so much for that. And Reverend Kim, I wonder if we might come to you now with a question. We have a number of questions about the effects of immigration on U.S. workers and the idea that this is all very complicated. In other words, there are illegitimate labor brokers and who really take advantage of and exploit migrant workers, that we have all sorts of issues regarding tax fraud and human trafficking and all sorts of issues that really underlie this system. I wonder if you could talk particularly about how U.S. immigration policies affect U.S. workers and how we can balance care for immigrants with our responsibilities towards other poor and vulnerable people here in our communities.
I think it would be important to note that immigrants form a backbone of our economy as it is right now. To remove them is to remove a backbone of our economy. I think of this time of the pandemic and the meals that we have eaten. Over 2 million immigrants are part of the U.S. food industry, harvesting crops, meatpacking in Nebraska, stocking shelves. 73% of farm workers, 40% of the food packers are immigrants. So literally, our food depends on the immigrant population among us. And during the pandemic, we've also seen the frontline essential workers that have been from foreign-born sources. About 30% of physicians are foreign-born. About 40% of those who are home health aides are foreign-born. And then you add on top of that, those who are second and third generation, and the numbers expand even more. So one of the things I think it's really important for us to establish to begin with is that our economy is profoundly dependent upon and benefiting from the immigrant population. A number of studies have also revealed that when there's an influx of immigration into a particular community, it tends to go into areas where there is already pre-existing vacuums. So the narrative that this is robbing jobs is not as true as one would expect. It is filling out the robust networks of jobs that are necessary for any particular community to survive. And the net impact is either neutral or often to the positive of a local economy with the introduction of a diverse workforce. And of course, you can go on in many different directions in terms of Silicon Valley and the dependence upon the H-1 visas in terms of immigrant workers. And the point is that by and large, the evidence is for the net positive impact of immigration upon the economic vitality of our country. It also is a recipe for abuse and the atrocious conditions in which undocumented workers can be asked to work in needs to be addressed, and it becomes a matter of justice for which the church, once again, should be on the cutting edge, the vanguard in our profound commitments to the dignity of all people.
My recollection from talking with you recently is that you have experience living in coal country. Is that right? Could you speak a little bit to that?
Yes. And, you know, there was a period after living in New York City for quite a while that our family moved to small town in Western Pennsylvania and moved around in a number of those small towns in dying coal countries during the 70s, when literally the industries were in the process of dying and communities were devastated. This speaks to the very complicated network of jobs that exist out there. And what we really need is a comprehensive way of revitalizing the kinds of work that our country is engaged in, looking toward the future of an economy that is shifting among us. And once we expand and diversify the economy that is necessary for the future we need, I think we will begin to see that there is ample space and opportunity for a wide range of workers, in multi-generational within America, as well as those who are going to be welcomed into our nation.
Thanks so much. I wonder if I might take this next question, Sabrina, to you, and then to you, Bishop Seitz, as well, for maybe a little bit more from your perspective. We have a number of questions, again, about human trafficking. And someone asks, what is this really like? How much of an element of what's going on at our southern border involves human trafficking? And are there resources in place to help these children and others once they arrive in the U.S.? Sabrina, I wonder if you might talk about the policy aspects of that. And then Bishop Seitz, I wonder if you might talk about, I feel like it's important to see what's really going on in these communities, because there's so many people who do help and support migrants. And I'd love to hear what's going on in El Paso on that score. Sabrina, can we start with you?
Yeah, definitely. It's an issue that is, there's a fine line to go into if you don't want to overstate that is happening, because much of what we see at the border is unrelated and completely unrelated to human trafficking. But it is a reality. And I mean, something that I gathered from talking to folks along the border, talking to Border Patrol agents, is that, I mean, to some extent, they are trained to get a sense of that. I mean, if they are seeing a group of 50 migrants arriving with many small children, I mean, they're trained to some extent to be able to decipher, okay, these children are clearly not with their family or things like that. There is a question of how to be better at that, how to have more better training around it, have more funding to help understand the issue better and help combat it better. And this isn't only a border problem. This is when we're talking about just the states on the border and throughout the country, there needs to be more effort done towards that. The Department of Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas has, talked about ramping up, not just having more agents, but having better trained agents and having better resources around this. So I would say, it's not the issue that I am the most familiar with in comparison to the migrants arriving right now, but it is a very real concern and one that you do hear time and time again, border agents and kind of the Border Patrol Union talk about as a concern when we're seeing heightened numbers of people arriving.
Thanks so much. Bishop Seitz, how about you? I think too often we just don't listen to people in border communities, and particularly the voices of the people who are doing the good work to help people who are being exploited. Can you talk a little bit about that in El Paso?
So many of the misunderstandings about what's happening on the border arise from the fact that there are important distinctions that people aren't aware of. When we talk about trafficking, we need to distinguish it from what you might call smuggling or accompanying, whatever words you want to use for it. So trafficking refers to people who are seeking to abuse and take advantage of the human dignity of those who are traveling, whether they're children or women or whatever group. And those situations are certainly present in this broken immigration situation that we face, needing comprehensive reform, right? But the majority of people who are coming are being contracted in order by the families of these children or these young families to guide them across the border. Okay. Now, you can talk about questions of legality and so on, and that's fine, but it's not the same as trafficking. And so those distinctions are important. And it's also has nothing to do with human trafficking when people in the church and other non-governmental institutions seek to make sure that people are not left on the streets of our cities and towns. They're not left in the desert without anything to drink. And there are many organizations. We're working together across denominational lines with secular organizations and the like, seeking to make sure that people who have felt the need to flee from their home countries aren't further victimized when they come across the border. And so we do the safe environment training, the vetting of our volunteers and so on, in order to provide a safe shelter for them and a place where they can land as they seek to arrange the next step of their journey.
Thanks so much. We have so many questions coming in. This has really obviously touched a lot of interest and concern out there. Lauren, I want to take one of the questions for you, and it's this. Someone asked that you're really taking a risk to be so public when the future of DACA isn't clear. So why did you decide to be a part of this conversation today and tell your story?
Yes, I think that immigration is an important issue, and every chance that I get to tell my story, I want to, just because there was a point in time when I first found out that I was undocumented and I just wanted to connect with as many people as possible just to know what their experience was like, because this was new to me. It was new to my family. Like, we had never gone through it. So I just want to share my story to other people that might not be able to tell their immigration status publicly, just to know that they're not alone and like we're all going through it. It's a learning experience for all of us. I just want to shine light to this issue.
Thanks for being here and for doing that. Before we get to our wrap-up question, I just want to go to you, Reverend Kim. Walter, just if you could talk, we have a lot of questions about divisions in religious communities and whether there's any kind of bystander apathy, if you will, among them, and how we can push against that. Do you see that kind of division in your community, and how do you work to push against it?
I think because the immigration debate has primarily been conducted in the political realm, it has been contaminated by the political realm. It becomes a polarizing, and it's not even just between left and right. I think the polarization is not just along a linear spectrum. It's like a series of magnets in a landscape that pulls us in a multitude of directions. I think the more that we can move it from the political, and I'm speaking to the church here and about the church, to the theological, to the human, to the ethical, and to the relational, that we are going to benefit greatly from that shift, because then that changes our ability to engage on the political side of things, because now it's theologically, ethically, and relationally contextualized.
Thanks so much. And as we wrap things up here, I just want to go very quickly around the group here and ask one final question. What's one thing people watching this dialogue could do to help address the human and moral and social costs of our broken immigration system? Sabrina, I wonder if we could start with you.
I think the number one thing that I would say is to listen to people that are on the ground. I think it's really easy, and I say this to this is my advice to myself as well. Is I think it's very easy to get swept up in what is Congress saying and what is the White House saying and what are we hearing in Washington, D.C. And I think we need to listen more to the folks that are on the ground along the border. When we're talking about the border situation, I think when we're talking more broadly about immigration, I think we need to listen to immigrants themselves, whether it's the migrants that have crossed, whether it is undocumented immigrants in the country, whether it is legal immigrants in the country that have been living here for years. I think if we focused the conversation around what folks that have come to this country and why they came to this country, we focus on that more, I think we'd have a much more fruitful conversation around immigration.
Thanks so much. How about you, Bishop Seitz? What's one thing people watching can do?
Sabrina took my answer. I think it is really essential that we humanize this reality, that we listen to those who are experiencing it, that we have the opportunity, as we have this in this gathering, to hear the stories, to understand that these aren't just numbers, they're real human beings, brothers and sisters. And it's not to say that ultimately coming to understand that immediately provides an answer, but it provides a context in which we can begin to approach and understand these realities. I think ultimately we're going to have to have the courage to think outside the box when it comes to resolving these immigration issues, because it's all been within these narrow confines of how do we enforce our law, you know, without really asking whether the law and its consequences are moral in the first place, you know. And ultimately, we're never going to come to an answer as long as we stay within those narrow confines. Knowing the flesh and blood human beings that are now among us and part of our country's beautiful history will allow us to think in a broader way and perhaps to find some answers to these vexing problems.
Thank you. Lauren, how about you? What's one thing that the people watching this conversation today can do to help fix our broken system and to help move us forward on these issues?
Yes, I believe the first step is to educate yourselves on immigration, and not forget the humanistic aspect of this. Also, call your representatives, donate your time towards immigration organizations, and don't forget that we are all hardworking people.
Thanks so much for that. That's wonderful. Walter, how about wrapping us up here? What do you think people listening to this call should take away from it and do?
Yeah, rather than add to the wonderful comments, I leave us with a thought. No one can do everything, but everyone can do something. So choose something.
Excellent. That's great words to leave us here with, and thank you so much. I want to thank all of you, Reverend Kim, Sabrina, Bishop Seitz, and Lauren, and thanks to all of you who have joined us here for this conversation. Just a reminder that this discussion will be recorded and posted for later viewing on our website and social media channels, and we'll also have follow-up resources available for discussion at our website, and I think they're already there now. I also want to preview some coming attractions. On April 29th, in collaboration with Georgetown's Office of the President, the initiative will hold a public dialogue on owning slavery, pursuing justice, seeking reconciliation, lessons from Georgetown and the U.S. Jesuits, with Father Tim Kosicki, the president of the Jesuit Conference of Canada and the United States, Joseph Stewart, the acting president of the newly created Descendants Truth and Reconciliation Foundation, and other leaders. And then on May 4th, we'll have a follow-up conversation on immigration for young leaders. This will be co-sponsored with the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, and it'll be a Salt and Light and Latino leader gathering to explore continuing challenges, new urgency, and the need for action on immigration policy. The panel will include Sister Norma Pimentel of Catholic Charities of the Rio Grande Valley and three young leaders. Please be sure to visit our website to see all of the details on these upcoming gatherings and information about other gatherings as well. I want to thank everyone who's joined us here today for this public dialogue. I want to give a special thanks to my colleagues, John Carr and Anna Misla, who do so much to make this dialogue run smoothly. I want to thank Reverend Kim, Sabrina, Reverend Bishop Seitz, and Lauren for their participation in this dialogue. And I want to wish you all the best, and we look forward to having you join us here in the future. Thank you.